the moves, 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 got the mojo.
The cutie marks?
He's got the moves, 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 got the mojo. 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 The moves, 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 got the mojo.
Good morning, and I realize it's nighttime over there. It's totally pitch black outside.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So,
how are you?
Sorry?
How are you guys?
We're good, we're good.
Well, fine, thank you.
Fun. Guys, you having fun today?
Yeah!
Yes! Woo!
Woo! Look what I wore. You see that?
You can see it. Oh, yeah, yes, you can see that. Wow! Fantastic! Yeah, all right, so, Vincent, before we get going, would you like to introduce yourself to those who may not be acquainted with who you are yet? Because we have a very wide audience here today. This is a Brony convention open to the public, and anyone just can step in and observe. So would you like to introduce yourself?
Well, hello guys. My name is Vincent Tong. I am an actor as well as a voice actor from Vancouver, BC, Canada. And I'm super excited to be here with you guys. And yeah, I do some voices for My Little Pony. And those voices would be
Prince Blueblood. I do the voice of him. Some of you might know his voice,
as well as Garble the Dragon and Donut Joe or Pony Joe, whatever you prefer, as well as Flash Sentry from the Equestria Girls movies. So
all right, pretty sure you're most well known from Flash Sentry, of course.
A little bit, yeah. I don't know if everyone likes it, but.
Well, it's great to have you with join us, and so a few questions for you to kick everything off. You, how do you say? When you got into voice acting, the thing is, we know you started with My Little Pony in season one. I mean, back then we didn't really know who was behind Prince Blueblood, but now that we do, when you were first given the script for Prince Blueblood, how did you react to it's a My Little Pony? Now, just did you expect the fan base already?
Well, the funny thing is like I used to watch My Little Pony when I was a child because there was like the 1980s version, the generation of Blonde. And so for me, I was like, oh, there's another show of My Little Pony. That's kind of strange. But I had a really good friend of mine, Ashley Ball, who voices Rainbow Dash and Applejack. She and I used to sing and dance together in a show choir. And so I asked her, like, what's up with My Little Pony? Because I know you do some voices on it. And she's like, oh, yeah, it's this new show, and there's a huge following called these bronies. I was like, what's a brony? So she told me all about it. I did my research, and I was like, wow, this is really interesting. But anyways, back to your question about Prince Blueblood. Yeah, that was a really interesting character, just because it was a really fun, regal, kind of a snotty, kind of conceited voice that,
you don't usually get to use a voice like this, so it was lots of fun to play with.
And I actually recorded that at home and then sent my audition in, and then found out that I got the job a few weeks later, and then recorded it with the cast, so it was really fun though.
Okay, so I'm sure that after that you were asked to come back on for Donut Joe and Garble as well as Flash Sentry. So yeah. How did you react to, was it a callback or did you volunteer for those roles or something?
Oh, I wish I could just volunteer and get it. Oh, I wish it was that easy. Daniel, you should tell them to let me do that. Because it's a much more difficult process.
Well, if I'm ever in Canada, I will.
Yes. But yes, we auditioned. Actually, Donut Joe, they actually just gave me that character. They're like, oh yeah, he's this, I thought, this is the weird thing, I thought he was a bartender. I was like, oh, okay. It's kind of strange that there's a bartender in Ponyville, but alright. So I gave him this kind of gruff voice, but then, I realized that he owns a donut shop, but he's got a bit of an attitude about him. So I kind of made him from New York, you know what I'm saying? And yeah, so that part was sort of given to me, which was nice. And then Garble, I auditioned for that one, as well as for Flash Sentry too.
So you said you imagine him as a bartender. So what was your reaction when you were given an episode where Spike just went to Donut Joe's shop and just sat there as if he was just having a bad day and just going to the bar after work kind of thing?
You know what? It's a really funny thing because those scripts, because it was just such a sparse, random character. Like, given these lines. So I didn't even know what was going on within the scene and the script until I watched it, you know, on TV.
That's an interesting way of working. I didn't know that. I thought all the cast would record together, actually.
Yeah, sometimes you do. If you have a very integral part with the show, you usually do record together. It's just this because Donut Joe was just given to me as, we have a character, his name is Donut Joe or Pony Joe in some episodes. Vincent, can you do the voice for him? Can you make him a voice? So I just did it, and then, oh yeah, they actually brought me back in to be like, oh, you know what, Donut Joe has a few lines in this episode, and I don't know what happens in that episode. I was just given the script for my lines, so sometimes that happens, and especially for Equestria Girls, when we're recording Equestria Girls, especially the first movie, because My Little Pony is such a female-centric show, when the guys come in, we actually, for the recording for the first movie, all the guys were in the room together. There were no girls. So we just went through the guys' scenes together because we never really interacted with many other people. Pinky, Twilight, Flash Sentry interacts with her, but because Tara is in LA, she records down there. So we never really get to see her. So for the first movie, it was just the character, the actors who played Snips and Snails, as well as Big Macintosh and myself that were in the room.
So Lee Tokar and Peter New.
Peter New, yes, as well as Richard Ian Cox. I think he does either Snips or Snails, I'm not sure.
Okay.
One of those guys. Yeah.
All right, so you mentioned that you are an actor and a voice actor, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's right.
Which came first?
The chicken or the egg? Very good question, Daniel. Let's go back down to 1585. You see the...
Just kidding. What came first? It would be an actor. I was an actor first. Because I did a lot of musical theater for the longest time. I was a musical theater actor professionally for 12 years before I started into the world of voiceover acting.
Sing!
Yo, we got a request from the girls.
What was that?
Sing. Someone wants you to sing.
Sing!
Oh, I can sing.
I can show you the world.
Oh, come on. Stop, you guys are too nice. Come on, keep it up. More. You know what, actually, Daniel, do you sing?
Yes, I do.
Because I just was on, you know, I'm doing my research about you guys, right? I'm on the website, and all of a sudden, this song comes on, this beautiful voice. I'm like, what's going on? Did I push some pop-up? What happened? And it's you singing on the website, isn't it?
Yes.
You have an amazing voice, man.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, we gotta... should record like a duet, an international duet sometime.
I would love to sometime, actually. I've been looking for a chance to.
That'd
be great. We should talk about that.
Oh, yes. okay, so when you said you did musical theater, what any particular musicals that you were involved in that, you know, was it on Broadway or somewhere?
No, not Broadway. I didn't get there, but I did a lot of shows in Vancouver as well as in Toronto. And Toronto is sort of our Canadian Broadway. We used to have a lot of commercial theater there. We still have a few shows over there. And I did Beauty and the Beast was one of them. Well, you see, you guys can't tell, but I'm on my computer right now, so I can actually look at my resume and see what I did. There's a show called Altar Boys that I did. It was a really fun show, kind of like a boy band group. And the 25th annual Putnam County Spelling Bee was a very fun show. West Side Story, I played Chino in West Side Story. I played a lot of like Spanish people. I guess because we don't have too many Spanish people up in Canada, so I got to play a lot of these parts. As well as La Cage aux Folles, which is a really fun show. I got nominated for an award for that show. Got to play this really flamboyant butler slash maid. He likes the cross dress, it's kind of funny. And then I did Mamma Mia for 2 years in Toronto.
Wow, Mamma Mia.
Yeah. Dancing Queen, I couldn't get those songs out of my head for the longest time. But yes, we did a lot of Dancing Queen, and we actually did a Lord of the Rings show. It was like a live stage.
Musical.
Yeah, have you guys heard of it? I'm not sure.
I don't think so, no, but Lord of the Rings musical, wow, I know people who would kill to go and watch that.
Yeah, there were some people that killed people. It was not, no, just kidding, nobody died. But it was a big spectacle. It was like the world premiere that we did in Toronto. It was a London production company. David Warchus, Rob Howell, all these people, Peter Darling. It was like a crew of people who've done amazing musicals, like Matilda, as well as, what else did they, oh, Billy Elliot. This group of people who created those shows created Lord of the Rings, and they had the world premiere in Toronto. So I played a hobbit, so they had to like walk really low, and all the humans had to wear sort of platform shoes so they would look a lot taller than us shorties, short hobbits. But we also played orcs and flying elves. I got to fly up on the rafters, and I think I did play a human at one point. But yeah, it was a really fun show. Very, very endeavorous, because it's such a big show, and three huge books condensed into one night of theater. So it was trying at times, but very, very fun and rewarding too.
You know, if Equestrian Girls ever becomes a stage play musical, I'm pretty sure they'll get you on for that.
Ah, well, I hope that I won't have to audition against you, because you have a pretty darn good voice, so...
Geographical advantage.
Who knows, with technology these days, I'm in Malaysia right now. It's crazy!
For that matter, have you ever been to Malaysia?
No, I have never been there, and I would love to come. I would love it.
Oh, one day, if you ever come down, we've got plenty of tour guides just for you over here.
Yes! So is everyone over there from Malaysia, or are there other people visiting from other parts?
We have Singaporeans in the crowd. Woo! Came all the way up for this.
Nice.
And, yeah. One from Vietnam.
Vietnam, nice. Cảm ơn sự đã.
And,
That's me saying iced coffee, probably in a very bad Vietnamese accent.
And of course from all around Malaysia, because this is in Kuala Lumpur, but we have people coming from other states as well, like Penang, and Johor as well, from the south, closest to Singapore.
Nice.
We would bring the party to you if we could.
Oh, that would be amazing. That'd be amazing. I'm so glad you guys all made it there and celebrating this amazing event. And way to go, you guys, Daniel, and you and all the crew for making this happen.
Thank you very much as well.
Absolutely.
So, speaking of conventions, when did you get your first taste of a Brony convention?
My first taste of a Brony convention was in my hometown, in Vancouver, Richmond, BC, actually. And it was BronyCan, and I think it was around almost 3 years ago. And yeah, it was really fun. Andrea was there, Andrea Lippman, who does the voice of Pinkie Pie and Fluttershy, and Tabitha St. Germain was another voice actor who was there, who does Rarity, and also Claire Corlett, and I forget which character she does.
Sweetie Belle, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right, yes, that's right, yeah. And Rebecca Shoykin. It was both our, she plays Sunset Shimmer in the Equestrian Girls.
And the singing voice of Twilight, isn't it?
That's right, yeah. So it was our first endeavor into pony conventions. And it was such a blast, I had so much fun.
And all of you, was the first time for all of you guys to go for going to?
No, it was the first time for Rebecca.
Okay. And so I'm sure you've been to a few more already.
Yes, yeah, I went to one in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. I went to one in Houston, Texas. And then I just got back last month from PonyCon NYC, which was so much fun to be in New York and see the East Coast bronies and how much love they have to give. It's amazing.
Have you been to any outside of the America, Canada convention?
No, I haven't. I would love to do that. I mean, yeah, some of my other friends like Andrea and Ashley have gone to like Australia, and I mean Tabitha went to Finland or something like that. So yeah, I would love to venture outside and go international and visit other people. I'm very surprised too that at the same time, there's such a draw for, I guess, North American English-speaking voice actors. I'm not sure how MLP shows up for you guys, but is it in English?
Yes, it is in English.
Okay, nice. So there's no dub in your own native languages in Asia?
No, but there are subtitles.
Oh, I see.
However, cool. Just a little bit up north in Thailand, they have it Thai dubbed, and that's the reason why a lot of us didn't see the Thai bronies until just lately, when they had their own convention that drew about 400 people. That was really huge.
Oh, nice. That's awesome.
And I believe he was in touch with your manager as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Cool. Nice.
Okay, and we'll just take some questions from the floor, but before that, we actually have a request from one of our attendees. He's not here at the moment, but we will do it later.
Okay,
we all know that you voice Flash Sentry. Now, when you auditioned for the role, I'm not very sure how voice actor audition goes, but if I'm not mistaken, they just give you a script. They don't tell you who it is. You're just supposed to bring out the voice and the character, correct?
That's right, yeah. I was told that he was... I can't even remember if he was supposed to be Twilight's love interest. I don't think that was on the description of it. And when I read it, I auditioned with a really kind of like energetic, because they said that in the description, he's kind of like a rocker dude, kind of like a poet at the same time. So he's kind of like that loner, stoic, kind of deep thinker. And I'm like, okay, cool. So I went in with like almost like a surfer kind of like vibe, and I was like talking like this. They're like, no, that's not it. So then I went like really like hard rock, and they're like, no, that's not it. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm totally bombing this audition. I'm doing terribly. But then I just thought of, okay, why don't I just make them really chill and relax? So I just started doing this kind of voice, and now it became. Gotta stop bumping into each other like this. And there he was, that was Flash Sentry.
So we have a question that asks, what's your opinion on the character of Flash Sentry after you figured out who he actually was?
My opinion on Flash Sentry? I think he's very lovable. I think, you know, I've definitely read a lot online, especially before my first PonyCon. I was so scared to go to my first PonyCon because of all the things that I've read online, because he gets a lot of hate because he apparently steals waifus. So I mean, but personally, I enjoy him. I feel like he's such a he looks cool. I think aesthetically, the way he's drawn, he's got cool hair. Kind of like me. And but he's such a dork at the same time. He's totally nerdy. He doesn't know what to say. He gets super nervous around Twilight. So he's an awkward teenager. And I feel that so many of us have been there, or not, still feel those same feelings sometimes. We just feel awkward around people. So I feel like he's quite relatable. But I know that that character gets a lot of slack from the pony fandom because of his potential adoration of Twilight.
Yeah, our musical director is not in the venue at the moment, but he wants to have a word with you about that.
Okay, I'm glad he's not here then. Isn't that nice?
Okay. Hold on a second. Where's it?
Yeah.
Just before that, we have a little bit of a question about the character of Flash Sentry as well. Chia, would you like to enlighten him?
Oh, I have a question. I'm Chias. About Flash Sentry from the first episode of Equestria Girls to the second episode of Equestria Girls. What do you think of the development of the character of Flash Sentry? Your opinion on whether he has gotten better or maybe not so?
Well, I think he's developed a little bit more. Unfortunately, a lot of the second movie, he was under a spell along with a lot of other people in the school. So he didn't get too much into his wants and potentially more character development, but I feel that they, I don't know, by the end of it, I'm sure most of you have seen the last movie, but at the end of it, he and Twilight are in an embrace, and then all of a sudden, Trixie pops up. So that was a fun moment to, you know, kind of play off of. But yeah, I think he's coming into his own a bit. Hopefully some more.
Hopefully. Definitely. So yeah. I don't think we can squeeze you for season 5 spoilers.
I know nothing.
Okay, well, if you're still voice acting, that does tell us something. Alright, hey, wait a minute, our music director is back in the hall, and yep, he's right.
Oh, look at the time, I gotta go!
Hi.
You guys are all in, like, pixelated purples and blues, so I'm not sure if this music director looks really tough or not. Hey, is that you? Oh gosh.
Give me a moment.
Uh-oh. He's just roving. This is scary.
Hi, my name is Meals.
Hi.
My name is Meals. I'm a brony musician, internet celebrity. I'm a kind of a big deal. I'm a married to Twilight Sparkle, all that jazz, you know. So I just, it kind of occurred to me that I seem to have just a little bit of competition.
I guess so, if you can call me competition. I'm not sure.
I'm not sure either.
I mean... of a generation.
Someone agrees. Thank you so much for your time, brother.
Thank you.
Alright, so getting back to the voice acting schedule and all. I don't know if it's inappropriate for me to ask, but is it your a full-time thing? Is it a thing that you do for a living, or is there because some of the voice actresses I know that it's not a full-time thing. So, I know you're a professional voice actor, but is it a full-time thing for you?
It is a full-time thing, yeah. I'm very, very blessed and very, very grateful and fortunate to call it a full-time job. I mean, along with acting as well, you know, I've been doing, like I said, musical theater for 12 years, and I've been able to support myself doing, working in the arts, which is something that's very rare. So I count my blessings every single day. I feel very, very grateful that I can say that, because it's such a tough industry to be in. And I know that every day I work is a blessing. So, for me, to do voiceovers, it's been a very great year for me this year. I've been doing many, many shows, and I've been lucky to have shows come back. You know, I do a voice on Ninjago. I'm not sure if you guys know about that cartoon.
Yeah,
it's a Lego ninja cartoon. I do the voice of Kai, the red ninja, and that one's been coming back for season after season, which is great. And so it's been very, very nice. And also some on-camera work too, which has been great. So I'm very blessed to call myself a working actor. This is what we strive for.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Thanks.
No, you're welcome. Hold on, just lost my train of thought for a second.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Am I on a really big screen right now? Can you guys
on a huge screen. Really sorry that ours is not as good, but yeah. We're looking at a huge screen. I'll send you some pictures after this.
Cool. I hope I look okay. Am I shiny?
You look fantastic.
How's that? Is that better?
look
10 years younger.
You can dye your hair blue to match Flash and that'll be perfect.
I know. I just put some highlights in my hair. What do you guys think?
Oh yeah, you can see that. Wow. Oh wow. Yeah, so the thing about the Malaysian brony fandom is that here, most of these people, they come from a wide variety of shows. We watch a lot of things on TV. I mean, most of them do. I only watch one TV show. So, I'm sure a lot of people here would have watched other shows that you are involved in. Now, we read a bit of your resume as well, and we noticed that you also do some voices for English dubs of animes, correct?
Yes, that's right.
So could you enlighten the crowd on what else you do?
For anime, I did this one called Story of Sankoku, as well as when I first started, one of my first gigs was Slam Dunk, which was a dub, as well as Death Note is the most famous one that I've done.
All right, Death Note. How many of you here watch Death Note? Come on, don't lie. Right there. Yeah, we got people in our vendor area who watch Death Note. Yeah.
Because, nice. I did the English dub of Famatsu.
All right, yeah, they recognize it. They recognize it now, so they say,
Nice. Chief Yagami, I'm not sure if we can do this.
Yeah, it was really fun. It was like, I was like a total rookie when I was doing that show, so it's kind of awkward when I listen to it, when I go back to listen to it, I'm like, oh my gosh, that was terrible. Wish you could go back and redo everything. But it's a learning process.
When you do some of the voice acting, you were in the same studio, and I'm sure that during the Rainbow Rocks and Equestria Girls recording, because Flash is quite a main character in those, you would be in the studio with the other voice actors as well, correct?
Yes, definitely, yeah. For the Rainbow Rocks one, for sure, yes, we were all together for that one.
So how is it like working with the rest of the gang?
Oh, they're just terrible. They're really mean. They don't shower. It's kind of disturbing. No, just kidding. They're all really sweet. They're all really, really nice. It gets a bit ridiculous sometimes because we laugh a lot and make jokes, so the director really needs to calm us down and focus us again. But no, they're really fun. They're all good people. I really enjoy the people that I work with. They're all really nice and there's no attitude, so it's great.
That sounds like a typical session in a coffee shop over here. Just sit down and talk to the cast, come home, and then we go out for a meeting or something, and then we realize that we diverted 10 miles away from the original topic.
Exactly. But for the dubbing, I'm not sure if you guys know that, but it's, when we're doing dubbing, like for Death Note, we're in the room by ourselves. And reason being is because we just get the full script, but with the name of our character, in my case for Death Note, it was Matsuda, and they would have a time code, and then I would have my script, the dialogue, and what I'm supposed to say. And we go in, we have our headphones on, there's a microphone in front of us, and our script in front of us, as well as a TV screen. And so we would hear beeps, we would hear three beeps, we go beep, 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 and then you speak. And it's really difficult, I find it difficult, to sync your voice to the mouth flaps as they're speaking. And sometimes it's written amazingly, sometimes it's written very poorly, and you have to cram all this dialogue within the mouth flaps that you see. So it's a totally different process than when you're just doing dubbing, as opposed to what's called prelay. And when we prelay, like My Little Pony, you prelay the voice, we record everything, and then they send it over to the animators, and then they draw to our voices.
All right. Yeah, I heard about that when Norman and I here. Norman runs a Malaysian Brony podcast, a friend of mine here.
Okay.
And we spoke to Michelle Krieber, and she told us about how that works as well.
Nice. Yeah.
And curious, I know that prelay and when we read from scripts, because I work in the news and I read from a prompter, so we're about to screw up a little bit. How many takes does it take to get to the final product for you guys?
Oh, sometimes it's a one-hit wonder. You're good off the bat, and it was an amazing take. But usually, it takes a few takes for some scenes. And also, it's how the word, the sentences are phrased. Sometimes you have words that kind of trip you up. But thankfully, we do get as many takes as we want to get the final product. And we have very great engineers over here that what they call Frankensteining the lines. And let's say you have one take that's amazing in the first part, and then the last part was really bad. They will cut it and stitch together that line and put it together. I think your job is way harder because you do the news, Daniel. So are you live?
No, I'm not live. Not yet, at least.
Okay. So do you get to edit your best bits?
Yeah, that's the best part about my work is that they gave me the video to edit. So if I mess up, it's all on me.
I see. Nice. Yeah, no, it's nice to have that luxury. See, for live theater, you don't get that. If you mess up, you gotta fix it.
Yep.
Then there, yeah. So, but it's also exciting at the same time when you do theater that way.
Yeah, true, because in theater the rule is the show must go on, everything on stage is delivered, correct?
That's right, yeah, you have to finish the show, so, yeah.
Yeah, that's why when we are on a podcast with Norman, it's just a catchphrase. In fact, we made a coin jar for it. Every time we say we'll fix it in post, you gotta put one in there.
Are you guys rich now from that coin jar?
Well, let's just say we are at 158 episodes. We made it as far because of the coin jar.
That's how we got you!
Sorry, yes, he doesn't need to say.
That's how we got you.
Oh, thank you guys so much. I really appreciate it.
The pleasure's all ours. So, hold on a second, yeah? So we've got a member of the audience who wants to know whether
yes.
Prince Blueblood and Garble are coming back anytime soon. Were you asked to put on the Cockney Gentleman voice again?
Yes, but not for the show.
That's good.
Okay.
I cannot answer that. I don't know.
Okay. We're trying to walk the line here.
I know. Oh, isn't it fun? It's always like the best question people ask, and they always get the same answer, but people always ask it anyways.
Yeah, we were told
we can't give any spoilers away. Sorry.
Okay, so, yeah, you're wearing a Brony t-shirt, so you definitely are well-versed with the fandom right now. So, I would like to ask, what else about the fandom are you into? Have you tried the comics out?
I haven't. However, I did read a comic down in Houston, because we had one of the Tom Zal, I forget his last name, he's terrible, but he, the writer of the comic was there, and we read his whole comic out, and who was there? It was Andrew Lidman, she was voicing, it was a Fluttershy episode, or comic, with Zecora, and Brenda was down there too, so we all read it out, and I didn't have any characters, so I basically did the voices for all the other characters, which was really fun. And I got to voice, what's the little white bunny? Fluttershy's
Angel?
Angel Bunny, yes. Because all of a sudden, Fluttershy in the comic book, she was under some sort of spell and she could hear the animals actually have voices talking to her. So I was voicing like a deer, and then a bird, a squirrel, and then I had to do the bunny. And I didn't know Angel Bunny didn't have a voice. So I put on this kind of voice and they're like, come on, Fluttershy, what you doing now?
This may not have been such a good idea.
You're not supposed to be here, Fluttershy!
Oh, we got a dog in the house. Look out, man.
Angry rabbit.
Now, every scene I do forever now on with Angel Bunny, that is what I will be carrying in my mind.
And the fandom just lost. The revival is so hard. It's just
good to be there. That was fantastic. That totally yeah. Suits Angel. He's got such an attitude.
He does. Yeah, he's like, what are you doing? What are you talking about, Sunshine? Come on now. So, I think if he ever has a voice, I should do it. I'm just saying.
Okay, so I'm sure that because you're curious about what you voiced, you do watch all the episodes, correct?
No, I don't.
But I'm sure you watch a few.
I've only watched a few. I've watched both of the Question Girls movies. I actually went to the movie theater for the premiere here in Vancouver, which was really, really fun. I went with Kazumi Evans, who does one of the new bad girls. Get Sonata or I don't know, I'm so terrible with all the names. As well as Ingrid Nielsen, who voices Mod 5. And so, yeah, it was a really fun experience going to the theater with them and watching it with a bunch of the bronies as well as the little broniettes, the little kids over there that love the show. So it was a really, really nice experience to watch the movie with everybody.
Okay, and how do you say? I hope I'm not overstepping any boundaries here, but your name is Vincent Tong.
Yes.
Yes.
It is.
Where are you from?
I am from Vancouver, BC, Canada. But my parents are from Hong Kong.
Hong Kong, okay.
Yes.
Because we were trying to figure it out, because we know Tong is an Asian name, and we were thinking...
Yes.
Because some...
Do I look Asian?
Yes, you do.
Do I look Chinese?
Actually, yes, you do.
Yeah? Really? Because most of the time, people say you look Filipino or you look Japanese. So I don't know.
I nod against that a lot. It's like, you Pinoy?
You Pinoy? Pansit lumpia.
What, you do a Tagalog voice acting now?
That's a little bit, yeah, those are the two things I'll order at a Filipino restaurant, so that's all I know. Just like Gabas, what that, maybe not the Vietnamese coffee. It's all about food with me.
Alright, so, we're gonna open up to the floor right now. Any questions for Vincent? Guys, anybody, any questions for Vincent? Come on!
Just because he is such an hairy, beautiful pony, unicorn. And you just never get to speak to anyone this way. So I really enjoy this voice.
However, I do like doing Flash Sentry because I feel like it's easier for me because I relate to him. He's such a dorky guy that's super awkward around girls sometimes. So, and he's a fun character and he gets a lot of attention, good or bad. So I like, yeah, the Donut Joe too. I don't know, it's so hard. Donut Joe's like a fan favorite. I enjoy it. I love talking like this. I wish, you know what, I wanted to like go around New York and talk like this the whole time, but then I was afraid I was gonna get beat up, so I didn't.
Wait, you go around New York and you meet at PonyCon.
At PonyCon, yeah. But the funny thing was, like, only like two people had New York accents.
The New York, there's such a thing as a New York accent?
Like from Long Island, if people are from Long Island, some of them, you know, they talk like this. It's really funny. I love it. I wish I could talk like this up here, you know what I mean? But we don't.
Okay, just asking, do you hear any like Malaysian accent in me or something like that? I don't know.
No, I hear a Filipino accent. I think you're lying here, bro, man. I think you're Pinoy. Don't deny your roots.
I'm Chinese Indian.
You're Chinese Indian?
Yeah. Question that's a broader scale right now. Since you have watched some episodes, read a couple comics, who's your favorite pony?
That's a very touchy subject. You know, at first, when I was asked this question, I always said Applejack just because she's, you know, Ashley Ball's a really good friend of mine, so I wanted to like be partial to her. But now I don't know. Because after listening to Andrew do Fluttershy so many times and hearing her just like kind of have random little Fluttershy comments when she's super shy, it cracks me up. I think it's super funny. So, I sort of like Fluttershy right now.
Yes. Fluttershy fans! And they cheer like Fluttershy as well.
Nice.
Okay, now, more questions from the crowd. Anybody else? All right, we've got one here. From Singapore.
Singapore represent!
Just a quick question. You know how you said you managed to figure out Flash Sentry's voice in the room? Well, did you do it in a flash?
I wish I had a drum set right now. I would give you a little rim shot. That was good.
You said there's like some achievement unlocked, you were not being there. But really, you didn't answer that. You said it took him a while. It took you a while to get it, right?
To get the voice?
Yeah.
Oh, it was an actual, I'm sorry, I didn't know if it was an actual question or if you just wanted to get the punchline out. I was sweating. I was in the room, I was sweating. I was like, I'm not getting this, I'm totally not getting this. And yeah, I just came up with it in a flash, you're right. I would just say, okay, I've exhausted all these other voices. I'm just gonna try to go with more of a more natural voice and more sincere. And it worked. And the funny thing was, is that I was driving to, I think, another session. I was doing a commercial, a voiceover commercial, and I bumped into Rebecca Shortkin. And I said, she was like, where are you coming from? Oh, I just did my My Little Pony audition. She's like, oh, actually, I'm gonna go for my Sunset Shimmer audition. I'm like, oh, cool. Well, good luck with that. I feel like I just totally bombed my audition. So it was very serendipitous that we both actually got the parts and we saw each other that very day.
Yeah, you gotta stop bumping into each other like that.
We gotta stop, or keep bumping into each other. We're gonna keep both the parts, right?
All right. So, any more questions from the crowd, guys?
Are you able to do a conversation with all five of them?
Well, let's see. You know what? I'll try just for you, okay?
Excuse me, how about me? I'm the person that deserves most of the attention. Come on, get out of here!
I don't know who that was, actually. Is that Garble? The Garble thing is kind of weird.
Because you know what? When I first went to Garble, he sounded like this. So I don't know what happened. If he, like, modulated my voice? I'm not sure what happened. But now I'm totally going astray with this.
But come on, man, what you talking about?
Man. Okay, sorry. Stop bumping you. You should like this.
That's all I got for you. That's all I got.
Thank you for coming, everybody.
Voicing.
Sorry, what did you say?
I said improv voicing. That was really difficult.
That was fantastic. I mean, improv is an amazing skill to have, and you've got it in you.
Do you think that Flash Sentry really loves Billy Waifus?
You start something here? You started something.
Oh no!
It's got to be starting something. It's got to be starting something.
I don't know if he knows what a waifu is. So I don't think he knows that he's potentially stealing a waifu if he doesn't even know what that is.
Ignorance is bliss, isn't it?
Isn't it? Just didn't know anything and just be like, oh look, that's shiny.
He just walks by and suddenly he's guilty of something.
Yeah, exactly. He's just trying to be nice.
So we've seen some pictures of you at PonyCon and all. And we're curious, you know, whenever we go to conventions, we come in with a fat wallet and then we come out with more bags than we have hands.
Yes.
So, what did you pick up at these conventions?
Ooh, good question. You know what? I really love visiting vendor halls because I feel that this fandom has so many talented artists, craft makers, card makers, you name it. There's so many talented people in this fandom. So I really enjoy going to the vendors as much as you guys do. So I have picked up posters, I've picked up badges and lanyards and chapstick. I bought My Little Pony chapstick in Houston. I bought a bow tie. Oh my gosh, I spent a lot of money on these guys. I have like a cutie mark, a Flash Sentry cutie mark, painted on me.
I thought for a second you got it permanently tattooed.
Yeah, that would be kind of hard to explain when I'm doing like live action stuff, but because I play a lot of gangster, so I'm not sure. It was really funny actually. I had the craziest schedule in the summertime. I had Edmonton PonyCon to go to. And then I had to fly to Toronto after all this love and pony fandom and talking about, you know, Twilight and Flash Sentry and Fluttershy. And then I had to go be an Asian triad gangster in Toronto for the Transporter TV series. You know, and I talked like this the whole time. I had dragon tattoo and yeah, got big chains and everything, you know, holding the knife and everything. Man, that was such a crazy transition, I tell you. So it was super weird to go from ponies to like the, you know, Asian triad member. So it was really fun though. I got to strangle a guy, and not for real, but it was a pretty bad part. It was really, really fun to do that.
I mean, if you have a tattoo, tattoos are pretty badass, aren't they?
Yeah, they are pretty cool. I don't have any just because I'm not that badass.
So. I mean, it's like you have a thief, and my wife would thief cutie mark on you. It's like, that's like some triad going on.
Yeah, I don't perform his own waifu stealing game. We don't steal money, we steal waifus. Oh dear.
Alright, before we close, I would like to open questions to the vendors. Since I know you all are manning your booths, you can't come to the front.
Yes, I wouldn't mind. Okay, I wouldn't mind.
So after doing your lunch, you have a certain urge to like eat lots of donuts.
Yup.
Alright, we got another question here from the Lunar Pegasus stand.
Are you bringing your agents or
I actually really am Jamaican. No, I am full-on Asian, Chinese, Vancouver, Canadian. We call ourselves CBCs over here, Chinese-born Canadian, or bananas. Because we're yellow on the outside, white on the inside.
No, there's a local Malaysian joke called CBC is China Bukan China, which is Chinese but not Chinese.
China Bukan China?
Yes.
Nice. I just spoke something in Malaysian.
Yeah, congratulations!
Yeah, the next time you go to the studio, you know I'm bragging, right? You've been to Bolo Loco technically already.
I know. Oh, I'd love to be there again.
You're
so cool.
Yeah, I mean, this is the first convention we're having here. The first time we're talking to a voice actor at an event here as well.
That's awesome. I'm so happy to be and feel so honored to be part of this. So.
I mean, the pleasure is all ours, Vincent. So,
my name is Alif. I would like to ask a question. Have you ever used any of your characters' voices in real life to mess with others? Aside from conventions?
To mess with others. I actually did do that one time. I went to Toronto and I met a new group of friends and they didn't really know what I did, and I didn't do voice acting at this time in my life. But I do a pretty good Chinese accent, like coming from Hong Kong and stuff like that. So I did it for them, and they were laughing so hard. So they were like, "Oh, but you have to do this. You have to speak like that to our friend Paul," because I haven't met Paul yet. So we were going to a party at Paul's house, and so for the whole night, I was like, "Hello, my name is Vincent. I'm learning English in Vancouver at the UBC. It's the university there." It's very good, it's fun. And the whole time, everyone's like asking me questions. Like, so Vincent, do you like Canada? I'm like, yes, it's good. and they're like, they're trying so hard not to laugh. And Paul's being so respectful. And they're like, oh, that's great, Vincent, that's great. And then someone asked me, like, oh, do you want something to drink, Vincent? I'm like, oh, okay. Oh, you have root beer. It's a fox has bite. And everyone trying not to laugh, Paul's like, yeah, sure, have some barks, that's great. And so at the end of the night, I said, someone asked me, we set this part up, so one of the people who were in on it was like, hey Vincent, do you know what the gullible means? I'm like, gullible, I don't know that word. It's Paul, do you have a dictionary? And so, oh yeah, sure, so he grabs his dictionary and he starts to look it up, can you read the definition for me? And she goes, oh, for sure, yeah, gullible, easily deceived. And I'm like, oh, that's it, oh, so easily deceived. Oh, that's pretty cool, that makes sense. Hey, man, can you pass the chips? And his face was like, what? And everyone started laughing, was like, we got you! And I'm like, I'm sorry, man, I had to, they put me up to it. And he was like, oh my gosh, the whole time I was trying so hard not to laugh. You sounded like such a weirdo, but it was, oh my gosh. So, yes, I did mess with people.
For that matter, can you speak Cantonese or Mandarin?
Yeah, I speak Cantonese, yeah.
Okay, you'll definitely survive in Malaysia. No problem.
Either. Oh, really?
You guys want to food again? I mean, most Chinese
don't
want to food that way.
Oh, no way. Oh, tell them all.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's how we do it.
You got to tell them.
Yo, tell them, yo. Yo, give me your one, your one.
Wow, your one. Your one.
Oh.
Nice. Yeah, hey, I heard you guys have
Tombstone. You guys have Tombstone? Yeah, he's gonna be on Skype as well later in the afternoon because, well, time zone Celestia's a little wonky. She raises the sun there differently than she does here, so I don't
know. Oh, yeah, she's a bit like that, right?
I mean, I don't blame her with a schedule like mine, you wake up at weird hours.
Mm-hmm. Tombstone's awesome, I love that guy. Please say hi for me.
No problem.
We met in Houston.
And I was like, you know, a fan of his, and I've heard so much about him. And we met at a party, and he was like, someone introduced us. And I was like, oh, I'm such a big fan of yours. You know, you're like all over the place, and blah, blah, blah. And he's like, oh, cool, cool. And then someone was like, this is Vincent. He does the voice of blah, blah, blah. And he's like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. I didn't know. And I'm like, oh, who cares of who I am? Like, you're the big star. And he's such a cool dude. We met up again in New York and at NYC, the PonyCon. And I was teaching a dance class there. I don't know if you guys heard about that. That was super fun. They asked me to do a panel speaking about musical theater versus voice acting versus live action movie acting. And I'm like, ah, that sounds boring. You guys want to learn a dance class? So I taught a dance class. And Tombstone came in and got jiggy to Bruno Mars' Uptown Funk. It was super fun.
So, wow, you can dance. We would love it if you're here. You can show us some moves and all.
I would totally love that. It was so much fun. We would totally get down. We would get jiggy about down there.
In fact, we're having an after party today. We've got a musician all the way from Singapore is going to be spinning for us.
Oh, nice. And is it right here? Are you guys going to do it in another room?
Oh, right here, right here. This is the only place you can afford.
Oh, it's awesome.
All right, so before we wrap up, any more questions?
What was your inspiration of being a voice actor?
That's a good question, Jimmy. I always mimicked things, and I was sort of a chameleon as a kid. I was very ADD. I couldn't stop moving around. And
I would always speak in different voices and like talking things. And
watching the older Simpsons and trying to do like Moe's voice. You know, hey Homer, what are you doing?
And then I,
I was constantly mimicking things, and like as a kid, I was a huge Disney fan, and so I never knew it was like a possibility to become a professional voice actor. For me, I was just a kid who did a lot of impersonations and different accents, and I would speak in different languages and stuff. But for me, it was after coming back from Toronto. I came back to Vancouver because I worked out in Toronto for 5 years. I came back and was like, you know what? I heard there's an industry over here. I took a class from Kathy Westlake. She was my very first and only voiceover class many years ago. And I wanted to do it. I just made a demo, made a really long, too long demo of all my voices. It was called Fridge Freaks, about a group of fruits and vegetables inside the fridge that needed to break out and escape the confines of this fridge. And then so that demo, I gave to an agent, and then the agent would get me different auditions, and then the rest is history. Now I'm loving what I'm doing every single day, and yeah.
All right.
And I was just wondering, considering the fact that you voiced one of the most overhated characters in the show, not for me, you're actually my 10th favorite character, but has anyone ever sent you any death threats or
insults online?
You know, personally, they have like, I read a few things here and there on my Twitter feed. I'm sure it's not directly at me. There's no death threats. There's been some awkward moments on social media, of course, because some people, you know, they're quite strong with their opinions, but, you know, to each his own. Everyone is entitled to their own opinions. But I feel like it is this whole waifu stealing issue is dealt with a lot of levity and humor, and it's all done with just a sense of humor. So far it's been all right.
Hello, Robinson. I am Norman Sanzo, and my question for you is, you said that you're, I cannot speak good English. What happened to me?
That's okay. That happens to me sometimes, and I'm getting paid for it, and I'm like, oh gosh, I'm gonna lose my job.
Well, I did 158 episodes of podcasting. I should be a professional at this, but I am shaking like a leaf. What the hell?
You don't have steady cam, let me take this for you.
Oh, thank you, Dad. Oh, wow. I needed the camera. Anyway, my question for you is, you said you're a professional voice actor, and you do that for a living. And
yes.
If you got the ultimate gig, like, let's just say you got a gig with The Simpsons, would you highly enjoy that and never regret it, or would you regret it later and wish you could do something more free and versatile?
What do you mean regret it? Like, you mean that's the only job I'll be able to do and nothing else?
Well, that is what you're known for, like how the voice actors part is known for.
Oh, I see, like you get pigeonholed and pegged just as that character.
Yeah, yeah.
I see. No, I feel, well, because voice actors have the luxury of not being seen, our voices can be versatile and we can play totally different characters. So I mean, a Billy West, who is one of my favorite voice actors, he does Futurama, he does Zoidberg, and he does like J.P. Fry, and he does a lot of different characters, but he's so versatile, and I feel like we have that luxury of changing our voices around, and not just, you know, we can't change the way we look because it doesn't matter. We can extend our reach a lot further than a film and TV actor can. But I would love, I mean, absolutely love to be on a Simpsons episode or a Family Guy show, you know, something like that would be amazing. So, no, I would definitely not turn that down.
Hello, Vincent. My name is Nick. My question to you is, besides performing arts in general, what other things are you passionate about?
Very good question. I like keeping physical. I really I can't sit still, like I said before. So I really enjoy anything that is active. So I play in a ultimate frisbee league in the summertime. Lots of running around. I've just gotten into parkour. I don't know if you guys do that over there, like free running.
Parkour, wow.
You guys know what that is?
Of course we do. Yeah. The thing is that places here are not very soft on the ground, so.
Oh, I know. Well, that's the thing. I used to.
In my younger days, I used to do stuff outside on the concrete. But now it's out in the middle. The knees are kind of hurting.
So I go to this gym that they built like bars and rails and foam pits and different height boxes to leap off of.
No way,
and,
it's like parkour stadium. I've been...
Sorry?
A parkour stadium of sorts, almost.
Yeah, yeah. And I just ripped the callus. I'm not sure if you can see that. But it kind of like ripped off yesterday. I've been learning to do like bar jumping onto a bar and then doing a backflip out of it. So that's been really fun. And I just learned this other wall flip, which is crazy, where you like kind of jump and plant your hands on a wall and do a flip around yourself like that. It's crazy. It's like a sideways wall flip. So yeah, I love doing that stuff. I'm really passionate about that. And martial arts as well. I did like Kung Fu and Tai Chi as I was growing up. And now I'm really into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I've only done a few drop-in classes, but I really love the art and the technique behind Jiu-Jitsu. Because I'm a smaller guy, I don't have as much strength to wrestle a larger opponent, but with Jiu-Jitsu, you're allowed, you're an advantage if you know what you're doing. So it's about technique rather than strength. And so I can wrestle people who are 200 pounds, and if I have the right technique, I can submit them or get into a dominant position, which I find very, very fascinating to use just our bodies and our limbs. It's not about how hard you can hit. It's about using whatever we have with our hands and our legs.
You heard that, Twilight fans? You heard that? The guy who's got your wife who's got some skills. You better watch out. So, before we wrap up, one last thing. Any more questions
from the crowd? Short, simple. Okay, one simple question. So, yeah, you're, of course, a voice actor, right?
Yes.
So, you must know about some juicy things that is going to happen in season 5. You can't see
I can't see anything that happens.
They've been laying down teasers all years. Before next month, right? It's all over the internet, all the teasers. So you cannot give us anything at all.
Send me the link, I want to see these teasers. You know, the voice actors, we sign non-disclosures about the work that we do. We are obligated by law to not speak about it, so we cannot answer any of those questions. Unfortunately.
We completely understand that. I mean, we're just dying to find out more. It's been such a long way, you know.
coming out soon, though, isn't it?
Yes, it is, and we can't wait to watch it again.
I know Daniel Ingram was saying that, you know Daniel Ingram, he writes all the songs.
Of course.
Yeah, we got to know each other better because we both were in New York together. We started doing rock climbing together. It was really, really fun. And, you know, he's saying that this is his favorite season for songs. So you guys are in for a treat because he's a very talented. Yeah.
You know, you said you got to know him. I'm trying to deduce something. That means you probably did some singing in there.
No, we didn't do anything. We did rock climbing, my friend. You know what, I cannot tell you anything about season 5, but you know what I can tell you is that I appreciate you guys so much, and I appreciate you guys having me on as a part of your inaugural Friendship Express convention, and I feel very honored and blessed, so I want to thank you guys so much for having me here.
Okay, this is a pleasure, it's all ours. So before we let you go, do you have anything?
Hold on.
Yes.
I want to say something.
Oh, go ahead, please do.
I want to tell you guys that I got you guys a little something. I went out, did some shopping myself, and I got you some stuff that I want to send you. And this is a Equestria Girls Pinkie Pie that I got signed by Andrea Lippman. There.
Oh, wow.
I'm going to send that to you guys. And I'm also gonna send you, this thing's probably not gonna, you know, just cause I want you guys to have either gifts for you guys or gifts to auction off or maybe potential raising funds for next year's convention. I have a card that's probably not worth too much, but I thought I'd give it to you guys anyways. It's a Donut Joe card and I signed that. So there you go, it's yours.
In fact, we're just gonna have a card game session right after this interview, you know?
No way. You guys can use that for, I don't know, whoever the highest bidder is for a charity auction or something. Yeah. And I also got you a Rainbow Dash as a Shadow Bolt.
Wow.
And that was signed by Ashley Ball. So, that's all from me to you guys. So.
Thank you very much, Vincent. And we'll see you really soon. Just before that, any last words to say to your Malaysian fans right here?
I love you guys, keep watching the show, I really enjoy your support, and I hope to come out to see you guys live next time.
We love you too!
No problem, live, on stage! Guys, can we get Vincent here next year?
Yeah!
Can we get Vincent here next year? Alright, Malaysia loves you, Malaysia wants you, Vincent. We'll talk to you real soon, alright?
Awesome, thanks guys, love you guys!
Thank you!
Feels like so many paradise. The happiness for